I'm going to read to you from Deuteronomy 32, verse 11. As an eagle stirs up its nest, hovers over its young, spreading out its wings, taking them up, carrying them upon its wings, so the Lord alone led him, and there was no foreign god with them. This talks about an eagle stirring up its nest. So why would an eagle who's taken the efforts to build up that nest stir its own nest? You know what's meant by stirring? It'll remove twig by twig until that whole nest collapses. Why would an eagle do that? And why would God use that illustration to say, that's why I'm going to leave you as well? So when we actually look at the nature of an eagle, eagles are meant to fly high, far higher than any other bird. So what these little eaglets will do is they will be happily sitting in that nest. So the mama eagle will carry the eaglets on its shoulders, take it high up, bring it back, leave it back in the nest. So the eaglets are happy to fly like that on mama's wings or dada's wings, they're happy to fly like that. But now they've got to fly by themselves. So now the eagle will carry the eaglet on its wings, take it high up and then drop it. These eaglets will be fluttering, then mama will come down, take it up again, leave it back in the nest. So the next day when mama goes back to the nest, now the eaglets know what mama's up to. Mama's going to take us up, drop us down, so they will not step out of the nest. They will just not budge out of the nest. The eagle doesn't have a choice. So it slowly stirs up its nest, removes it twig by twig, until the eaglets drop. And then it goes up, picks them up, gets them to fly. That's how they learn flying and they soar the skies. God does the same thing to us. He stirs up our nests. Not that we like it, not that I like it. We don't like God stirring up our nests. We love it when He builds it up. Nice, cushiony and cozy with some cushions here and there. And so I don't drop. But we worship a God who stirs up our nests. And that's what we're going to see. Why does He stir up our nests? There are two words that rattles me when I hear it from God. And I'll tell you why at the end of my message, why those two words rattle me a lot. The two words are go and let go. When I hear these two words from God, it rattles me because when God says go, He's pushing me to a place of uncertainty. I don't know what that place holds to. And when God says let go, He's pushing me out of my security. I'm feeling insecure. So I'm quickly going to take you through instances in the Bible where God uses these two words, go, let go. Okay, shall we dive into it? I may ask somebody can just quickly read our passages when I say the passages. Thank you. Charles Stanley says, God is responsible for the consequences of our obedience and we are responsible for the consequences of our disobedience. Okay, so there's a level of responsibility we pin down to God and there's a level of responsibility God pins on to us. Can somebody read Genesis 31, 1 to 3?
Now Jacob heard the words of Laban's son, saying, Jacob has taken away the death of our father, and from what we are father, we have acquired all the wealth. Jacob saw the countenance of the Lord, and he was not favorable towards him before. Then the Lord said to Jacob, return the land of your father and to your family, and I will be with you.
So this is the scenario. Jacob has worked 14 years for two of his wives and then continued working, multiplying the stock of Laban. And then he hears Laban's children, his first cousins, talking, saying, hey, this guy came out of nowhere, taking away everything from us. Okay, the boys don't know the history, so it's okay. But then he realizes even Laban's countenance is slowly changing. Now, this is the father-in-law who cheated him to get Leah married to him. And he said, okay, we'll still be there, we'll work for him. He's kind of a good man, he's my uncle, and goes on. But now, Jacob clearly has this sense of, I'm done. I can't handle this anymore. And God clearly says, go. God clearly says go. Now what you must understand is Jacob is a person who's used to moving. The first time he moved out of his father's house, he was single, all alone, no problem. I can move from here to there, lie down with a stone on my head and still come to the other side. But now Jacob's not like that. He's got two wives, he's got 11 children, he's got cattle, he's got servants, he's got men and maids, all around. It's just a battalion of people. Now God is saying go without Laban's knowledge. Do you think that's a possibility? Jacob cannot stay invisible. It's a battalion of people with him and her and whatever he had and kids around him. I'm sure God, Jacob contemplated, I can't escape. This is too big a crowd. It was not the first time he escaped from home. This is too big a crowd. But he did go. He knew it was an impossibility. He knew I will be found. But when God said go, he said I'm going. It's beautiful when you read that passage. He goes quickly to Leah. He says, Rachel, it's time we move out. Both the wives said, yes, we are moving out. So this huge regiment and a battalion going with him. If Jacob was my dad, I know how he would have reacted. Hey, kids, stay quiet. No making noise. Let's move from place to place silent. He managed it all quietly around. But then the beauty is Laban comes to know. In 3 days' time, he catches up with Jacob. And this is the verse Laban says, Genesis 31, 29. He says, it is in my power to do you harm. It is in my power to do you harm. But the God of your father spoke to me last night saying, be careful that you speak to Jacob neither good nor bad. God was telling Laban, let go. Let go. The beauty of it is when God told Jacob, go, he decided he will let Laban let go. You're so worried about when God says, go. But I want to encourage you, every time God says, go out of your comfort zone, he's commanding, not requesting. He's commanding somebody else, telling them, let go. To the extent I like this word, don't even speak good or bad. Forget about it. Don't even speak anything good. Just let go of that man. That's the first instance I want to quote for you, because when we obey God, the consequences, the situations around us could be adverse. But when God says go, it's best we go. Now you may ask me, okay, yeah, God's been good. He told Laban to let go. Now what about if God doesn't tell him to let go? I'm stuck. Okay, let's check another instant out when the man has used to let go. Esther. Okay, again, I'm not going to the story of Esther. Esther 4:16 says, the bold woman says, if I perish, I perish. And she decided to go because God said, and she was sure, I have fast about it, I've prayed, now is my time to go into into the king's presence, and if I perish, I perish. She goes, okay? Now the whole community of Jews are waiting for Esther to go. So the plan is, I go to the king and I make the request. Good? Because going to the king itself is difficult. Finally, she shows acceptance and says, come on, Esther, what is it you want? Perfect time to say what you want, because you found favor in the king's eyes. And then she withdraws saying, can you come over for dinner? The king was at dinner and you came all the way to call me over for dinner? Okay, I'm coming. And she's come with Haman. It's okay, I'm coming. She goes back. And then it's dinner time. It's either that day or the next day, it was dinner. The king comes and Haman comes and now he asks again, Esther, what do you want? I give you half my kingdom, take it. Best time to put a proposal across, say what's happening. And she again says, come over for dinner tomorrow also? King must be wondering, what's wrong, Esther? I have a good dinner at home. Why is he constantly calling me over for dinner? Okay, place yourself in Esther's place. Esther must have been wondering, what a stupid thing I did. Two opportunities God gave. He put me in the presence of the king and both the times I withdrew. There was a purpose for that delay. When God said go, and then withhold. He didn't say withdraw. He said withhold. Now's not the time. There was a purpose behind it. I want you to quickly run through what happened that day and night. The king couldn't sleep. The king must have been wondering, what's wrong with Esther? She's calling me twice. There must be something behind it. And then when the king doesn't sleep, usually he gets singers or dancers, you know, to soothe him to sleep. But the king calls for people to read the chronicles to him. And exactly the chronicle that comes up is the one that relates about Mordecai and how he saved the king's life. And then the king says, have we done something for him? And everybody around him says, no, we've not done anything. Really, haven't? Now what's Haman doing back home? Haman is busy building up the gallows. It says it was so tall, I guess it was 90 feet tall. The understanding of 90 feet is, when Haman actually hangs Mordecai there, right in front of his house, everybody in the town can see Mordecai. So nobody messes up with Haman again. That's the point. The point of the hide was that everybody in town can see him. Nobody messes up with Haman again. So he's busy building up the gallows and he's happy because next day it's one of the he knows the plan. And then he goes to tell the king about everything. And then the king says, is there somebody there? Yeah, there's Haman there. King, you know, Haman's even more happy. King is calling me. And then the king tells him, whatever you send Haman to do for the one who pleases the king, go and do it. Worse in Haman's life. But it became even worse. Can somebody read Esther 7, 12 to 14? He comes back rushing home out of shame. He's irritated, he's upset. Afterward, Mordecai went back to the king's gate, but Haman hurried to his house mourning with his head covered. When Haman told his wife Zeresh all that his and his friends, everything that had happened to him, his wise men and his wife Zeresh said to him, if Mordecai, before whom you have begun to fall, is of Jewish descent, you will not prevail against him, but you will surely fall before him. While they were still talking about this, the king's eunuch came and hastened him to Esther's wife. Now comes the realization for Haman, oops, I should have let go of this. I messed it up. And even before he can correct the error, he's taken off in a hurry to the king's dinner with Esther and rest the story. You know what happens? Esther says what has happened, and Esther says it's Haman who has done it. And king doesn't say anything. He only walks out in rage. Because it's Haman, he walks out in rage. While Haman does something extremely stupid in his frustration. And that had to happen. He goes leaning towards Queen Esther and that irritates the king. He says, you do it when I'm around? Into the gallows. When God says go, and then he says withhold for some time, there's something happening behind the scenes. That one night was extremely important for Esther. She could have told the kings two nights earlier itself, but it wouldn't have worked out like this. Haman would have still been there in some other time of space, 3-5 years down the line, he would have still continued creating trouble for the Jews. If God has to wipe out completely, when God says go, you have to go. And when God says let go and the person doesn't let go of you, the problem is for that person and not for you. Third thing, John 8:3-11, it's about the adulterous woman. But there are some times when God tells us go for a particular reason. You know, the adulterous woman, the people in that city catch an adulterous woman, bring her to Jesus and say, this woman, according to Moses' law, has to be stoned. We caught her in the act of adultery. You're not reading that passage, but that's what it says. We caught her in the act of adultery. Now, you can't catch a single person in the act of adultery, right? If you catch two people in the act of adultery, and only then it becomes an adulterous act. And the law of Moses clearly says, when you catch two of them, both have to be stoned. But these are smart guys. They wanted to pin Jesus down, so not only the woman there, and you know what Jesus does, yes, write something on the sand around that, and he says, whoever has not sinned, you take the first stone and throw it on this woman. And the best part of it I like is, the oldest person puts the stone down and goes away. That gives me a sense of, I don't know what, turning old? Yeah, more responsible though. Okay, and everybody goes away. So when God says, let go of my child, he also gives his child a command. He tells the woman, go, and sin no more. You go, don't come back to this place where you sinned. Don't come back to this point where I redeemed you from. So is it with all of us. You know, God redeems us from different situations, from different phases in our life. And he tells the rest around us, don't ever touch her. She's my child. Don't ever touch her. But he equally gives us a command. He says, go. Never return back here. His forgiveness is not a license for me to sin again and again. Stay cautious. I'm sure Pastor Aisha and Uncle would have spoken enough about it, but stay cautious. His forgiveness is not a license for me to continue sinning. So sometimes when God says go, especially for the paralytic man, you know what God said? Go, sin no more. Otherwise, something worse will happen to God. That's a big one. That's a big warning, okay? Yes. The fourth time when God says that, again back to Jacob's story, Jacob is pretty interesting. He's running all around the place and doing things that God has him in his hand. Okay. Genesis 34:40. Now Jacob has a daughter called Dinah. Okay, she goes out inappropriately. I don't know the background behind it. But she gets defiled by the men of that land, the man of that land, because one of the men loved her and defiled her. And they come back to Jacob saying, I want to marry your daughter. So Jacob says, let me speak to the brothers. So the brothers also stay quiet about it. But they come to an understanding, okay, if all of you get circumcised, because that's a Jewish tradition, all the men in your clan also get circumcised, we'll get Dinah married to you. That was the agreement, so all the men in that clan got circumcised. Now what these two brothers, second and the third brother, that's Levi and Simeon, they go and kill every man in the clan. And when they do that, this is what Jacob tells them, 34:30.
Then Jacob said to Simeon and Levi, you have troubled me by making me obnoxious among the inhabitants of the land, among the Canaanites and the Perizzites. And since I am few in number, they will gather themselves together against me and kill me. I shall be destroyed, my household and I.
Okay. Initially, he was scared of Esau, then it was Laban, now it's the people of that land. Jacob tells his children, what you guys have done, you messed it up. They will surely come back and kill us. Dead end. You can't escape because you're a foreign land. There's no way to escape. But let me read from 35:1. It says, then God said to Jacob, arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there and make an altar there to God who appeared to you when you fled from the face of Esau, your brother. So God said, listen, every time I said go, you went, and I was your safety. Esau, Laban, now it's the Canaanites, every time I said go, you went, look back, and I was your safety. Do it again, and Jacob does it. So much so, 35:5-6 says, and they journeyed, and the terror of God was upon the cities that were all around them, and they did not pursue the sons of Jacob. How do you like that? The terror of God fell upon all the cities that nobody touched Jacob, and the sons are grown up. They didn't touch Jacob, nor his sons, nor their families. Sometimes God asks us to refer back. That's our reference point. You did that then, won't I with you? You did it again, won't I with you? Do it now, I'll be with you. It's not about who is pursuing us. They could be the biggest army. They could be the majority. It doesn't matter. But it's the God who reigns the heaven and the earth who's commanding me. He's the Lion of Judah. He holds the mighty armies in his hands. When he says go, he will command the nations to let you go. That's the God we worship. Fifth one. We all know this, right? It's about 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes. We know that, okay? Again, in that story, I want to emphasize this. It's not about the bread, it's not about the fishes. I'm sure all of you know it. He could have done that miracle without the bread and fishes. He's done it so many times. Out of nothing, he brings life. So food out of nothing is not difficult for him. But then he's commanding his disciples to exercise their faith and say, go, go search. It's an impossible task. 5,000 people, but he says, where will you go find food, Jesus? Even if you were to spend all the money, you won't get food. Jesus, go now, tell me who's go. And he went. And he was telling this little boy, let go of your breakfast. Now, mama's packed in their breakfast, right? I know one, when my kids were small, they come back home, I'll ask them, did you eat all your food? Yes. Did you eat all your food or you gave it to your friends? And they said, we all ate it. They come back home. So one strict rule in the house was, if you want to take 2 lunch boxes, okay, don't come back home hungry. So any mama who packs up the food will pack it up only for the little one. God was teaching that little one to let go. So he let go. I remember a long way to go back home. I know mummy remembered they gave it to you. I know the rest were fools. They should have brought something to themselves. They walk up the mountain, they come this far. They should know they go back home late. You were the smart kid, fine. Let go. So let go. This whole miracle was not a test to God's capacity. It was a test to my ability to let go. It was a test of my ability. God will test us. God will test us again and again and again, and we will fail again and again and again. The deal is what, Lord? You show something, then I let go of this. How can I let go without seeing anything? You show one or two small miracles, I let go of this. But God says, you first let go, I show. Have we had these conversations? Have we had? I've had it many times. Lord, I don't see. Like Elijah said, Elijah's servant said, I don't see anything. At least show me a little cloud. Cloud of fist, I believe. But every time God says, go, He's testing my faith, not His ability to do miracles. And the last one. Sometimes we let go, but we keep a watch of it with our peripheral view. You know what I mean? We tell kids, go have fun, go have fun. But you're constantly scanning them. Where are they going? When are they coming? Who are they going with? No, but Mama's had that. We have the peripheral view, we'll keep watching everything. But we look like we talk to the person in front, but my view is always here. Okay? One such thing was Genesis 19:20. Can somebody read Genesis 19:16?
Genesis 19:16. And while he lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand, and upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto him. And they brought him forth, and set him without the city.
Okay, so you know the whole story again, right? So this is after God telling him, you better step out, I'm going to destroy. And you know all that happened around, the way the people treated these two angels of God and all that. And then the angel telling him, Lord, let's go. Let's go, because this place is going to be destroyed. And Lord is still lingering. Even after the command is go, I let it, Lord is still lingering. And you know what's lingering? You just go like this and you come like this, you not make a decision. But the angels are saying, it's time to go, it's time to go. And then seeing Lord lingering like that, the angels hold his hand and drag him up. Hey, I'm not going to give you the choice. I'm going to drag you up. Sometimes God drags us up. It hurts. It hurts big time. And it's because I'm loitering, I'm not able to take that conscious decision. But God knows that place is going to be destroyed. That's not your place. I want you out of that place. And He holds us by a hand and drags us out. And so was it. But you know what 19:23 says? The sun had risen upon the earth when Lord entered Joab. So it's already risen. Then the Lord rained brimstone and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah. 26. But his wife looked back behind him and she became a pillar of salt. When God says go and let go, yes, there are things we let go, but we constantly keep watching it with our peripheral view. I let go of this, when is God going to bless me? I let go of my family, when is God going to bless me? I let go of my riches, when is God going to bless me? We're constantly having this in our view. God, you said let go, I've gone, but what have I let go? I've let go of this, I've let go of that, I've let go of this. And we keep a score of all that we let go and telling God, you better settle those scores. I let it go for you. And you know, and our checklist becomes longer and longer and longer. When we let go, we don't look back. If we look back, we can't proceed ahead. She froze. Have you seen that in our lives many a times? When we constantly look back at our past, we will freeze. We will have no hope for the future. We are fed up because we're constantly living in our past. But God's gracious. Here's the last one. Exodus 14:10-15. Okay, so you know this. The Israelites are coming out of Egypt. And then when they are out, they suddenly look back and see Pharaoh is chasing them. This guy who was brooding the death of his firstborn is suddenly picked up his army and he's chasing him big time. Okay, so 14:10 says, and when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were very afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, because there was no graves in Egypt that you have taken us here to die in the wilderness, why have you dealt with us to bring us up out of Egypt like this? They look back, they see Pharaoh and his army. Pharaoh and army is another level. You can't fight against Pharaoh and the army. And they're coming with their chariots. The beauty lies here. I made it 14:15. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. And he told Lot, he said, go forward. He must have looked back and said, where to go forward? We cannot go at the speed at which Pharaoh and his armies are coming. And there's Red Sea in front. Where to go forward? And this is what happens. 14:19. And the angel of God, who went before the camp of Israel, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud went from before them and stood behind them. You understand the concept? Whatever was going in front of them now goes behind them and stands, which means now that is in between Pharaoh and the Israelites. Now even if the Israelites turn back, they can see only the pillar of fire and cloud. They cannot see Pharaoh and his army. Sometimes God is gracious to us. Sometimes He's extremely gracious. When God says go, we have to go. When God says let go, we have to let go. I don't know which phase of life you are in. Maybe God will tell some of you lovingly go. Just go. Trust Him. Maybe you're stepping into uncertainty. It's okay. He's already there. Just go. And God's been telling some of you to let go. Please let go. You may feel insecure because that's the place you've always been in. Now God's asking you to let go. It's absolutely okay. He's a loving Father. Let's bow our heads and pray. Father God, you know each one of us personally. Not by name, but by our lives. You've been speaking to us, Lord. We've been avoiding it, Father. Because it's a tough thing to do what you're asking us to. But Lord, today I pray that when we obey you, Lord, the consequences belong to you. You are responsible. We leave it all at the altar and take our hands off. If you've told any of us to go, give us the strength to go. And if you've told any of us to let go, give us the grace to let go. In Jesus' name I pray.
Oh, my.
us from falling, and to present us faultless before the throne of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. God bless you.